The following program is brought to you in living color on NBC.
Well, good afternoon and welcome to Capital Bylines, I think. This is Living Color. I'm Betty Groebli, and I really hope you have very little to do over the next 45 minutes because my guests are the Joy Boys. They are Willard Herman Scott Jr. and Edward Heston Walker, two of the most unpredictable and incredible and talented personalities in all of broadcasting. So I hope you can join us, and you'll hear from both of these great names in the news next on Living Color NBC. I think few of us can claim the distinction of going away to a private school at the terribly tender age of five, but Eddie Walker did just that. He left his parents and his sister in Forest, Illinois, where he was born, and he entered the Maryland School for the Blind, where he became editor of the school paper. He was president of the dramatic club. He was on the wrestling team.
Not when I was five.
Then he was in charge of the PA equipment for all the school functions. And as if that weren't enough, he had the lead in the senior play. That was Belvedere, I think, the thing that Clifton Webb did, right, Eddie?
Only he did it better.
Oh, he did not. Yeah. Then after high school, as most of you do know, he entered American University, and he was the very first blind student to do so. And for 2 years, he majored in sociology. Well, meanwhile, back in Alexandria, Virginia, Willard Scott, the only child of Selma and Willard Herman Scott, was busily involved in his own sociological situation. Turns out that he was an entrepreneur at the age of nine. He made his first public broadcast when he was 13, and by the time he was 15, he was the youngest page at NBC. Now, Willard, we're going to back up right here. I'd like to find out about this nefarious activity in which you were engaged at the age of nine, please.
Well, first I should comment on Eddie Walker. You say that he operated the PA system at the school over
yes.
there in Maryland. He sold Prince Albert to the kids, taught them how to smoke.
I was hawking that on the side, yeah.
This was not, had nothing to do with the public address. What was the question?
Let's go back to this business at nine.
You mean when I was working...
You're selling commercials for 25 cents a piece.
Well, Eddie and I both, unbeknownst to each other, because he and I did not know each other at the time, but we had what was called a phonograph oscillator, and for $3.95, you could order this from Olson Radio out in, where's it, in Kansas
yeah,
City?
Yeah, catalog,
something.
Yeah.
You just get this little, you know, radio ham operators type catalog where they sell all sorts of equipment, you know, for radio, record players and things like that. And it's a phonograph oscillator that you plug into the wall, works off electricity, and it's like a little amplifier, and it's like a little miniature transmitter, a radio station. Mm. And you could plug a phonograph into it, and you could play records. The idea was it's a wireless phonograph. You could play records from one record player, and you put this in your house, and at a certain, you know, designated spot on the radio dial,
pick it up
anywhere in the house, and it was sort of the first interplay home music system, see? So I had one of these, and I later found out Eddie had one, too, and I had one in my basement. And the station, we had a station, and we were much more advanced than Eddie's, because I've always been, one of those real...
And modest, too.
Oh,
mine was
very
more
modest.
Educational than his. I didn't sell spots.
He didn't sell commercials, yeah. See, but mine, we had a call letter, WSSD, which stood for Willard Scott Sharp David, and I never can remember who Sharp David was, but we had stationery. We called ourselves the Commonwealth Broadcasting Company, CBC, because we lived on Commonwealth Avenue, and there was a shopping center up about two blocks from my house, and I used to sell commercials to these people. We operated on Saturday night from 6:15 to 9 o'clock. We opened up with Guy Lombardo, then we had an all-request program, and then we had a fellow who's now a rabbi, Jimmy Rudin, a very dear friend of mine, who had a show called Rudin's Portfolio. He was 10, and he commented on the world. You can imagine. And he was good. He was good then. He's a very successful rabbi now in Kansas City and one of my very dear friends to this day. And what we did was to sell commercials for 25 cents to the beauty shop, the drugstore, and the DGS grocery store in the shopping center two blocks away from the house. Unfortunately, they couldn't pick the station up two blocks away. There are about eight houses in the neighborhood who could pick this station up. So that they would be satisfied with their commercial, we would invite them in on Saturday, and they would sit and listen to the program and watch it being broadcast from my basement. This phonograph. And after the show was over,
yes.
We had a little cigar box. We passed it, and they could give contributions to help improve the equipment. And we made from $20 to $25 a month.
Why don't we do that around here?
Listen, I
think he's doing it in the basement.
That's right. And then with that money, once a month, we would buy a good movie, Laurel and Hardy or something like that. And we
you mean buy or rent?
Rent it, I should say.
Okay.
Yeah. And then we'd show the movie on Saturday and have a kiddies cartoon carnival in the basement. And we really cleaned up on this because we sold popcorn and the kids had to pay 10 cents to get in. And we made about $30 a month with that operation. And things have gotten progressively worse since then. I hit my peak when I was 9.
Well, then you also told me the story about meeting Truman, I think. Was this you were 12? Is this what happened, Will?
13, 14.
How did you meet President Truman?
Well, a very dear friend of mine, Dave Vaughn, who's now a labor lawyer down in Atlanta. And Dave was a friend in high school. And Dave's father, Major General Harry Vaughn, who's one of the finest, most upstanding gentlemen that I've ever had the pleasure of being associated with in my entire life. At the impressionable age of 12 and 13, and now as a man, I'm 30 years old. I don't know how old he is, but I respect him as much, if not more, then. But it was sort of an ideal situation for me as a kid to be, you know, you could write one of these little pamphlets and send it out to high schools all over the country. A local boy in the city of Alexandria who lived in the, you know, shadow of the nation's capital. Having Dave as a very dear friend, we used to go to the White House and swim every Saturday morning, and I did this for 2 years while Mr. Truman was in. I lost my swimming rights when...
When he was in the pool or while he was in office?
Well, he was in the office at the time, in hot water sometimes, but I never saw him in the pool. But they invited me, the Vaughns were nice enough when I was 13 to invite me to the first Army-Navy game. And I've only missed one since then. That was when I was in the Navy at boot camp and couldn't get away, incidentally, because I loved to go to the Army-Navy game. But we went up on the presidential train, and being 13, we didn't drink anything stronger than Coke or ginger ale, and we had our own little compartment. There were four of us, all boys, about 13, 14, and really a thrill because the president was in his private car. And we had heard that he was going to come to tour the train, as President Truman just pops in anytime he wants to, you know, like the late President Kennedy. Mm-hmm. He was very unpredictable about when he would show up and where he would be. So I had my face, I was sitting on one of the Pullman benches, I guess, in this little compartment, and I was facing the door, and we just ordered some ginger ale. And so we thought it was a porter. There was a little knock on the door, you know. The door opens up, and it's President Truman. Well, I was so excited, I stood up immediately at attention and banged my head on the upper berth, and he came over and rubbed it for me.
And it's never been the same since.
No, nor him.
What about this first public broadcast of yours, Willie? Was this for Murphy's or something?
Well,
announced the specials of the day?
I was about 12. Now, I wasn't quite in high school, I remember, because the reason that I left the job, I wasn't a mature male. I was in Murphy's store and G.C. Murphy over in Alexandria, and they wanted a guy to, you know, run the PA system. I was horning in on Eddie's job.
Yes, yes.
Eddie had the PA system for Sears. I was working the Murphy room. We were both aiming for the bus station because that was, you know, that was soccer.
For the real big
that's big
audience.
Time PA. So anyway, I did get the little job down there. A very dear friend gave me the job, who was a manager at the time. And
got you out of the basement.
Got me out of the basement, and so I worked the PA system at Murphy's for about 6 months, but I lost the job.
Why?
You want to tell this?
No, I didn't really know.
Well, they had one day, you know, you'd advertise, you know, special sale this week. Pecans, 35 cents a pound, counter 13.
Yes.
Ring a little bell, then you play some music. And they brought me an announcement about some ladies' lingerie,
mm-hmm.
particular item that, being 12 and 13 at the time, you know, was sort of taboo, and I'd never spoken it, only in, you know, hushed whispers, and that was back behind the hen house, you know, when you were trying to discover what life was all about. So they brought me this little message to read about this particular ladies' lingerie item and different sizes to read. And I refused to read it. I said, I may have friends in the store at the time, and they'll, you know, they'll
yes.
think the less of me. So I left. I left G.C.
And you
Murphy's.
Left.
To this when day, he doesn't know what those items are, I won't tell you. You got to see him blush when he reads those commercials.
That's right.
We eventually are working up to when these two great people finally got together. But first of all, I would like to explore a couple of things with you, Willard, about the fact that you were the youngest page NBC has ever had, and this was when you were 15.
That's
was that
right.
Here?
That's right. It's a very, I guess, a little story that I like to always tell because I've always loved this station and this network, especially NBC. Even when I used to write, you know, guys in high school would write girls' names on their notebooks. I would always draw a heart, and I'd write NBC through one side and my name on the bottom.
Oh, Willard.
I hear groans.
Oh,
I hear groans.
Dear.
That's all right. I don't care about you. I don't need you guys. I was always a very loyal
employee.
After
that, you may need them, Willard.
Now, listen. Many times, I believe that a good employee is never an employee who agrees with his boss at all times. So I've never always agreed with the boss, whoever the boss might be at the time. I've always spoken my 2 cents worth, and because of this, I have felt that they respect me for it. But I love this place very, very much, regardless of what they think sometimes and the way that I act. But anyway, with the page job, I wanted to be a page so very badly because this was real ambition as a kid, my first year and second year in high school, so because I was 15 at the time. So I came over to Miss Eleanor Ferguson, was in the personnel girl on the job, and she explained to me that I could not be a page. Because I was too young and couldn't get a work permit and all that stuff, and NBC tradition, which I've broken many times in the past.
Yes.
But I started out breaking an NBC tradition because I finally got the job as a page. And I remember that I said a little prayer, you know, and I stopped in because NBC used to be down 14th and New York Avenue, and I was a Baptist at the time. I can be anything, really, but I happened to, you know, be a Baptist, a Presbyterian, whatever, you know.
That day.
But I went into the Epiphany Church over there, a little Episcopal church on G Street, and I said a little prayer. And 2 days later, they called me, and I got the job as a page. And I'm not trying to create any kind of, you know, plug for funds here, but it was a sweet story and a very real story to me, and I appreciate it. And
you still have the first dollar you made.
Still have the first dollar I ever made at NBC. I made $6 on Saturday and $6 on Sunday, and I ran scores to Johnny Batchelor. He had a show called Bachelor's Quarters. It was on every Saturday afternoon for 2 hours, and they would bring period football scores in, and my job was to run those. And the first dollar I got on the top of the pay heap, I got paid by Petty Voucher for 4 years. The only guy to have Petty Voucher. Petty Voucher.
She's still here?
She's a redheaded kid.
Oh, yeah.
She's getting older now. Varicose Voucher, they call her now. But I got the first dollar I took off the top of the heap, it was $6. See, I took the first dollar, and I saved it. And a few years ago, 2 years ago, General Sarnoff was in town, and he was down at Sheridan Carlton, and his credit card was, you know, in them there. So I called the office, and I asked to speak to the general, and so I spoke to him on the telephone and explained to him that I had this dollar, the first one I'd ever made, and he said, fine. So I sent it to him, and he kept it. No, he signed it and sent it back to me. And I have it now framed.
Now, while you were a page, is this where you met Elizabeth Taylor and Spencer Tracy and Joan Bennett and also Mrs. Roosevelt, and you began stealing fur coats at that time?
That's right. Yeah, well, that's probably the most dramatic story of my paging career, and I say I was a page for 4 years. Mrs. Roosevelt was on Nancy Osgood's program, the same show that you now do that she did then, and Mrs. Roosevelt was being interviewed that particular afternoon. And we had all been alerted, as we were every weekend, to take good care of our guests. They would come in. And Mrs.
Roosevelt. Changed, I'm sorry.
That's
to say,
changed.
But go
well,
on.
I'll go. Listen,
no,
after
really
today, I may be back.
Better.
I'll be back on the paging staff after today. But and that would be a pleasure. Mrs. Roosevelt came to the studio, and I met her at the elevator door at the old Translux building, the second floor in BC. And she came out of the elevator, and she had this beautiful Persian coat on. It's not a, what do you call it? Comes down to just about the waist.
Three-quarter length. Yeah.
Yeah. Right. And so. Normally, we just take the coats and hang them up in the hall out there, see, but I said, no, it's Mrs. Roosevelt's coat, so I'll take this coat and guard it with my personal body. So I guarded the coat, and she went in Studio E down there and was being interviewed. And after, for some reason, I got carried away and was somewhere else, when she had to leave in a hurry, and she couldn't find her coat. And so about 2 minutes, I heard this screaming in the hall. Mrs. Roosevelt has gone. She has to go to a DAR meeting or something. And she was down on 14th Street, and I finally caught her just as she got in the cab. And as she was getting in the cab, I helped her put her coat on. And I was apologizing, and she was saying, that's all right, don't worry about it, she could have gotten it later. But I held her back there for a while.
And finally, you were not as taken with Elizabeth Taylor as you were with Joan Bennett, I understand.
Well, that was one morning. I was on the page desk one morning, and they were doing United States Steel Hour. Remember that show, Eddie?
Mm-hmm.
And they brought the show to town for the Red Cross kickoff about 1952 or something. Polly Wright was an extra in the show, and Johnny Batchelder, then an announcer here, was also an extra on that program. They did it from the Constitution Hall Theater, stage of the Constitution Hall, and Elizabeth Taylor played the original role, and Spencer Tracy was here, and so was Joan Bennett. Well, they all came to old Studio A down at the Translux for rehearsal that Saturday morning. And Elizabeth Taylor looked, I better not say that she looked like she just got out of bed, but so I won't say that, but she looked like, you know, she looked pretty wild. Her hair was all spun up, and she was in a pretty kooky dress. And she looked terrible. She really did, all honesty. But she was a beautiful girl. She was 18 or 19 at the time, and couldn't have been more in the flower of feminine beauty. But she looked like the wrath of, you know. So
yeah, I think you mentioned that.
Yeah, so Joan Bennett was there, and she's about 45 or so at the time, and she was magnificent. Beautiful skin, pretty hair, nice figure, and she was so much more gloriously glamorous to me. And so I took her down to People's Drugstore and bought her a Coke. And I told her, now the old people.
You always had class, Willard.
Lots of class.
He does.
I said, Miss Bennett, I know all
very
these
Tony.
All these guys are making over Elizabeth Taylor, but I said, you are so much more beautiful than she is, and, you know, you got so much more style.
You bought her a Coke.
She thanked me and drank her Coke, and she paid, and we all went home.
Eddie, you were telling me about a friend. I'm not sure whether you met this friend while you were at Maryland School for the Blind or while you were home on vacation. This engineer from WOL.
While I was home, a member of the church we attended, still attend, Fourth Presbyterian Church, this fellow's name is Ted Belote. Some of the engineers that have been here a long time might remember Ted. He started out with the WMAL back in the early 30s, back in the days when Godfrey was at MAL. And then he went to WOL, which at that time was owned by Coles Broadcasting Company, which published Look Magazine. And they were the Mutual affiliate here in town. Mm. And I met Ted and let it be known that I was interested in radio. And I was about 7 years old at the time. And he used to take me with him on band remotes. They don't do that much anymore, but, you know, they used to pick up the Navy band and the Marine band. They'd go down to the old War College and places like that. And I'd go with him and wear a pair of earphones, and I thought I was really hot stuff. Because I'd watch him put these things on the air, you know, and this was, to me, this was great. This was living. And that's how I got interested in radio, or got started in radio.
Is he the one, can we hear this record that you made? What is it?
I'd rather not. Well, now, he made this record for me when I was 8 years old. So, and
what's
actually...
what's it called?
This is a, at that time, I used to memorize a lot of things, sort of Paul Parrott things. And this was one of the old Moran and Mac routines, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And this was one of the records that I had in my record collection, and I memorized this thing. And he recorded it for me one day. And my mother used to tell me that every time they'd play it for friends, I'd run in the closet and hide. And there's no closet in here to hide in.
We're going to, I'd love to hear this.
I would really rather not.
Bear with us. I'm really sorry. John Hickman, I think, was able to get it for us. But before we do, let me remind you of something that I don't want you to forget. This is about Miller's Seamless Floors. Now, this is perfect for the rec room or the kitchen or the bath or the dining room, and we've been telling you about it for, I guess, a couple of weeks. It's a continuous flow of seamless wall-to-wall beauty that just will not collect dirt or moisture or germs simply because it has no seams at all. It's actually poured on. Now, you can get it in the color and the pattern of your choice. It can be installed over both new or existing surfaces. There is absolutely no maintenance, except cleaning, of course, but never any waxing. And it is so durable and beautiful, we have mentioned this again many times, that two of the biggest pavilions in the New York World's Fair have it right down there on the floor. And they also tell me, I have not seen this, that it can be used around swimming pools because it is so resilient to chlorine, acid, etc. Now, all you have to do is call 524-2430. That's the telephone number for Miller's Seamless Floors. It's in Virginia. And they will be very happy to go out to your house, give you an estimate without any obligation whatsoever. So again, the telephone number is 524-2430. Well, there's more to a muffin than meets the eye. If it's made with Washington Hot Muffin Mix, plain or fancy, high light golden brown, delicious right out of the oven and dripping with butter. So try them with blueberries or raisins in the batter and many other ways, too. The recipes are right on the box, and Washington Hot Muffin Mix comes in the handy single-serving box, just the right size for your family, and no leftovers. Your quickest way to a quality home-baked hot bread treat made by the makers of Washington Self-Rising Flour. And now we're going to listen to something that was made by Eddie Walker when he was 8 years old.
Well, if you insist. Where'd it go?
About that, but always remember that a rolling stone gathers no moss. Well, why not? Well, because it's rolling. Yes, but rolling where? Well, anywhere. Well, who started it? Well, how do I know who started it? Well, how do you know it's rolling? Well, everybody knows it's rolling. It's just an old thing. Yes, but who said it? Well, how do I know who said it? Well, how do you know who said it? Says what? Well, how do I know? Well, that's just it. You don't know anything. If ignorance was an alley, you'd be a boulevard. Well, why? Because you're a dog. Yes, but in what way? Well, you haven't even the ambition of a worm, have you, huh? I don't know if I have the ambition of a worm or not, because I never saw a worm's ambition. But I have more ambition than your brother has. No, but my brother's smart. He's got brains. He has, and I bet if he has, he'll scramble with eggs. No, my brother's got a good head on his shoulders. Oh, that ain't no head. That's just a knot on his body to keep his spinal cord from unraveling. Boy, and he's bow-legged, too. Boy, he can't help that. Yes, and your sister is knock-kneed. Well, don't you dare say anything about my sister being knock-kneed. I ain't saying nothing. But your brother is so bow-legged and your sister is so knock-kneed that every time they stand beside each other, they spell O-X, ox. Boy, if I hear any more of that talk, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to take my fist and sew up your left eye. Why ain't that funny? It don't read that way in my book. No, in my book it read as he sews, so shall you reap. No, it ain't going to come out that way. I'm just going to hit you so hard on top of your head, I'm going to break both of your ankles. Yes, and if you do, I'm going to chase you so hard that by the time you reach your house, you'll faint 10 times without even falling down. That's all.
Eddie, you've aged since then when you were 8.
Yeah, just a little bit, yes. No, those are the good old days, Betty. Yep.
We want to get you out of high school.
Get me out
now.
Of this, will you?
Get you out of that. And then... I know you both met, as we mentioned before, at American U. Mm-hmm. Why did you decide, Eddie, after you graduated from high school, why did you decide to go to American U?
Well, they had they offered a course in radio and television. At that time, they were one of the few colleges that did.
Mm-hmm.
And I wanted to go into radio and television very much. So I talked them into accepting me as a student out there. And I was sponsored by the Vocational Rehabilitation Agency here in the district.
Okay.
And they didn't think that it was at all feasible for a blind person to go into radio. So they said, why don't you major in sociology for the first couple of years, and then if you can prove to us in that time that there is a future for you in radio, we will let you change your major, because you really don't concentrate on your major till your junior year. I know some kids that never concentrate on their major, but anyway...
Ed Willard was one of them.
I did this, and then at American U, I met two guys, Roger Gordon and John Galloway, and the three of us found some old equipment that was used for some radio and radio speech classes. They had a control panel and a couple of turntables and a microphone. And we unearthed the old phonograph oscillator that Willard was mentioning earlier, and we started the campus radio station, WAMU. And we started it in the summer of 1951. There was nobody there except a couple of painters and a few summer students. There wasn't anybody to listen. So we'd run around and we'd take portable radios. This was the only excuse we had for getting into the girls' dorm. And we said, we want to see how strong the signal is up here, see? So we'd go and we worked diligently to try to get this station heard all over campus. And that was the beginnings of WAMU. And that's where I met Willard. Willard was going to go to AU the following year, and Roger Gordon, who was a mutual friend, brought Willard around to show him the campus one night, and he came into this radio station, which was in an old temporary building called Roper Art Studio. And he came in, and Willard and I started kidding around on the air, and that was the beginning of the Joy Boys.
First word we ever said to each other, which I think is a little interesting, was on a microphone,
yeah.
Because Eddie was on the air talking at the time, and Roger said, why don't you slip in across the desk and introduce yourself? So I did, and so the first words we ever spoke to each other were spoken over the ether waves.
And we never talked to each other unless we're on the air.
But you missed the best part of that American University story. The only reason that station ever got off the ground at American University. He mentioned the fact that the studios were in the old Roper building, which were art studios at the time. And they used to have models posing for, you know, a live portrait painting. And, you know, between it's pretty tough to run a board and have your eye in a keyhole at the same time. But these, it drew a crowd anyway. But the shows weren't so hot, but...
When you left there, I know, Eddie, where did you go to work, Eddie, after you left American Union?
Well...
Of course, you had a job in the meantime. Both of you did, didn't you? Some part-time job?
Yeah, now we...
At the same time we were in school, we worked.
We worked at WOL. Willard was still a page here. And then we literally made an audition tape, and we walked the streets to different stations to try to talk somebody into hiring us. And we went into one radio station one day. We mentioned this on the air the other night. And we were sitting in the lobby, sort of cooling our heels, waiting to see the manager. And on the monitor, they were playing a rock and roll record, and the guy is singing, "I Ain't in the Mood." And we took that as a hint, and we got up and left before we ever saw the guy. So then we went over to WOL, which, as I told you yesterday, I think is a little ironic, because the first things I had to do with radio were with WOL, and the first time I got on the commercial airwaves was at WOL. And George Campbell was the program director up there then. And we played him the tape, and he didn't say anything, you know, and he's sitting there, and I'm poking Willard. Is he smiling? And after the thing was over, he said, "That's fine, we'll put you on Sunday night at 11 o'clock. Well, who listens to the radio on Sunday night at 11 o'clock? And I remember my first paycheck was for $5 for that show, and then the show was extended to Saturday night. We were on from 10 until 3 in the morning. That's while they checked the transmitter or something.
Yes.
And then we were on Saturday and Sunday night, and then Willard came over here as a full-time announcer, and then they sold WOL, and that was it for me over there. And then I went to work at WPGC, and I was, I was right up there with those, number 15 on the Hall of Fame this week, you know. And I worked Sunday afternoons. Everybody was at the beach but me, you know, and I tried to get somebody to work for me. Nah, I couldn't do it. And I had the Billboard magazine puts out a thing called the Honor Roll of Hits. Anybody's ever read Billboard? And they have the top 100 hits. So I'd take a stack of 45s. I'd start at 1 o'clock on Sunday afternoon, and I'd play every one of those 100 songs. And the summer, it was a daylight station. In the summertime, I was on from 1 in the afternoon until 8:30 at night. With one 15-minute break for guest star, one of these Treasury 15-minute transcriptions. And I
can imagine what he did.
Yeah. And hope the needle didn't get stuck.
He probably had a commercial just like this.
You know who I am? I'm Rust. When I get on the sink, tub, or tile, I'm impossible to get off.
I'm a deep, dirty, stubborn stain. Ain't nothing can get rid of me either.
That's how it was in the good old days.
We used to be impossible.
Then she got wise to Zud.
And got rid of us just like that.
And cleaning the impossible is as easy as Z-U-D. Special purpose Zud cleans up after the other cleaners quit. And Zud removes the terrible rust and stubborn stains that no other cleaner can touch, like water stains and rust on tubs and sinks and tile. And don't forget the tarnish and corrosion of aluminum and copper. And it isn't easy clean after you cleaned up the usual way, then Zud the rust and stains away. It really works, and the nicest thing is you don't. Zud has earned the good housekeeping seal, so try Zud, the special purpose cleaner.
Us dirty guys don't have a chance since they invented Zud.
All
don't
right,
be
you dirty guys.
Use Zud. I got more, but I think we better not use them.
Willard, for those who haven't heard your show, how about helping me out here and doing one of our turbo bats?
I'd be delighted.
All right.
Ready? Ed, if you would like to help in any way possible while I'm reading this, go ahead.
Yeah, I'll rub your back while you have
Well, these are very beneficial to people who are nervous and have, you know, little problems at the end of the day where you just can't seem to get relaxed. I have had the pleasure of using this product, home. I don't have one at home, but I've used them in the health club, yeah.
Really?
They're great, yeah.
Well, without reading it, just tell me what it is.
Well, it's a little, it's a motor, and it has a hose on it, and the hose goes into the bathtub. It's completely safe, completely, you know, no chance of electrocuting yourself or anything like that. It's all protected and all union labor, laboratory and all that stuff. And it circulates the water in the tub, see?
Mm-hmm.
And this is very, very good for you to relax you. Get the water good and hot and sit in the tub and just turn this machine on and let the water completely circulate and bubble around you. And it's very restful.
Does it really feel great?
Oh, yeah. It's like a
like a massage kind
of? Best thing to a massage, yeah. Very
and it's
good.
Called, Willard, what is it?
Turbobath.
Turbobath.
It's an Irish product. Turbobath.
We started it over there, and we brought it over to this country, and it's a big hit.
They use Irish whiskey in the tub over there, you know, old potatoes. What are you going to do with them? And then you rub it.
Give us the phone number there.
Sure. You can call right now, Metropolitan 8 2380. 2380. These people will install this in your home for you. They call it here a personal whirlpool massage unit.
All right.
And you can call them right now.
Now, let me talk to George, since we have this tape brought into us. Do you have the first show that Willard and Eddie did on WRC queued up?
He made it. What do you mean?
It's called 2-in-1. Is it queued up? Let's go with it. Let's hear it.
Live from Studio One, the National Broadcasting Company presents in color, black and white, radio, radar, and sonar.
This afternoon, live from Studio One in the spacious studios of the National Broadcasting Company in Washington, D.C., Communication City, we are proud to present for the first time a program of news, music, mystery, entertainment, weather, time signals, crow calls, a montage of our business, the business that's known as show business, in color, black and white, radar, and sonar.
This is the first program to run for 108 days continuously with no station breaks and no commercials. Just entertainment from us to you. You will get glances of Broadway plays, both past and present, vignettes of life and living, touches of a living theater, interviews with stars of today and yesterday, great moments in show business, the latest record releases. Such prominent names as these will be our guests.
Gertrude Hilderberg, Manya Fink, Rosetta Rock and Roll, Perry Hobo, Bing Crosley, Jackie Sadsong, Lolly Baby, Minerva Fezfuss, King Farouk, Kimo Sabe and his magic violin.
You will attend the premiere of an emotion picture, so this is Rockville and Montgomery Scope. A specially recorded interview with Aristotle, plus the singing and dancing talent of the Marlon Brando dancers. Featuring for the first time, Marlon himself doing a tickle toe.
And for variety, an on-the-spot broadcast of Lorenzo Jones talking in his sleep, revealing some of the hidden facts of his lost memory. And you'll hear the elopement of two flamingos direct from Chesapeake Bay. The music of such big-name bands as
Dylan Bago, Sawed-Off Finnegan, Les Green, Cuss Morgan, Percy Dowd, and Hugo Summerstopper.
And many others, including for the first time on any medium, anywhere, the musical interpretations of Johannes Brahms conducting his own orchestra. All this and much more, for this is Grab Bag, the most spectacular of all spectaculars.
When year? What year
Don't
was that
humorous.
Done? What year was that done, Willard?
Eddie, you're been on dates.
Oh, that was pitiful.
It was not.
Yeah, it was July the 11th, 1955.
Marvelous.
Yeah.
Hoot Gibson, doesn't he do a beautiful job? Do James Mason, Ed.
Eddie, you went in the Navy shortly after that.
This was on about a year, wasn't it?
Well, let's see. This came on July 55, and you went in the Navy November 56.
I think we had a lot of fun with that show. And one of the reasons was it was on in the afternoon at 1 o'clock, and we had two shows back-to-back. Bob Reed was on at the time. And was he on after us or
yeah,
before?
Yeah, after us. And Patty Kavin was on before.
And Patty Kavin was on before us. It was all live radio then for what, you know, live radio was in those days.
Yeah.
And the reason that this was even appropriate, this little bit about this grab bag feature, was that at the time NBC had experimented with those programs that Margaret Truman and Mike Wallace did, and Virginia, what's her name?
Virginia Graham.
Graham, you know, and they did these shows. And it was the same type of thing where everybody in the world was interviewed. There was nobody left to be interviewed, you know, because people were interviewing each other after a while. And that's the reason we did that particular skit. But this show was fun because we did it in a studio down at Sheraton Park. with about three or four engineers with us working on the show with sound effects and special effects, and it was really an awful lot of fun.
I think people are fascinated to find out how you put the show together that you do now.
Well, basically, it's the same. There's one big difference. Then the program was almost everything we did was planned because it was, what, 55-minute show?
It started out a half hour and then went to 55.
And then they took 5 minutes out for news at 1:30 or something like that. But everything we did was planned, and what you can do in an hour program, you know. But now we're on with ours is now a basic format of music and commercials and a lot of silly
stuff. Let's talk about the hours you're on.
8:05 to 11 o'clock, three-hour show. And
We have some stock characters that we rely on, like the Sod Buster and his sidekick, Chester Drawers, you know, and what's the takeoff on Gunsmoke. And then we have Just Plain Stella Bear, which is the only soap opera left on radio.
We've been doing it for almost, what, 6-7 years?
Yeah. Then? And we have Robin Hood of Rock Creek Park, Betty Crockett, our home economist.
Charlie Chain, the Ace Oriental sleuth, who always ends up with some stupid line like, you know, what do you call it? What's the word? It's a, you know, like, I can't even
trademark that.
An old expression, like...
slip of the lip can sink a ship, and we work that. That's the whole, we build up to this whole thing, and usually it's pretty bad, but it's, you know, kills the 3 minutes.
And, there are several others, too, that we do.
But do you talk about this before? Do you talk about it while a record is playing?
Yeah, we will come up with an idea, and while the records are on, we will outline it. We don't write anything as such.
Well, here's an idea, one skit we haven't done yet, and this just happened. We were talking one afternoon about this. You know how when you go to a country club dance or you go to a dance at the Shoreham, a lot of times people will stand around the bandstand or they'll dance, you know, slyly dance up to the bandstand, and over the Shoreham they'll whisper in Bob Cross's ear or they'll yell across, "How about playing the Stardust next?" Yeah. And Bob will, as he's conducting the orchestra, he'll smile and, you know, say, "Okay, that'll be the next tune," and then the next tune is Stardust. But we have a situation we're going to work up where Leonard Bernstein is conducting the New York Philharmonic in the Lincoln Center. And, you know, this kook is wants a request.
Well, melancholy baby,
yeah, that's right. How about Beethoven's finger, guys? Please, I'm conducting. No, this is a very, that type, then we'll talk it up like this, and then sometimes, of course, it comes off, and it can be very funny. We sit back here, I think the bit that I like the best that we do, and the one that I believe we get most comments on, is a bit we do every Friday night called WWVO in Seagram's, West Virginia. And this is a typical takeoff on a hillbilly station, and it doesn't mean West Virginia could mean anywhere as far as that's concerned, where they have these giveaways.
Everything is $2.98, you know.
You heard the show where late at night there's always one or two stations you can pick up on the dial where they sell anything for $2.98. We have a rural magazine that they can subscribe to, Plowboy, pictures of animals in the barnyard, you know, in bathing suits and stuff like that. And
they have a new rural soft drink called Federal Aid.
Cures everything.
The all-purpose elixir, you know. And we talk like this, and we play, you know, here's the latest release by Lazy Luther and the Sugarloaf Mountain Boys. Know you're going to love this one. Here we go. Let's play it now.
Lazy Luther and the Sugarloaf Mountain Boys goes over big because, of course, Sugarloaf Mountain is right outside of Rockville. Everybody knows that. And it's so spontaneous, and we listen to these things back after a couple of weeks, and some of them are pretty cute. Some of the offers are pretty cute. We had a hearing dog for old hound, a hearing aid for old hound dogs. We gave $2.98. Yeah. You know, make your old hound dog sluggish here this fall. You want to go rabbit hunting, and maybe he's 12 years old. He's not as good as he used to be. So it's a special Japanese for $2.98 to people from Yokohama,
all
Japan.
All transistorized.
All transistorized. Put this on the dog's ear, and he's gone, man. He'll take off after anything.
Ideally, I asked Eddie this yesterday, I'd like to find out what both of you would like eventually to do, you know, your ambitions.
Get away from each other, I guess. Try to get rid of the stigma. See, he's nervous. He always calls when he's nervous.
Yeah, I'm nervous, man.
You tell him.
I would like to, we're partners all the way.
Don't blame me for this.
my ultimate aim, I'm very happy on the air, and I'm a ham, and would love to stay on the air, but eventually I would like to own a radio station or own part of a radio station. Mm-hmm. And when you get too old to perform, you know, in the days when Granddad is me and then I have to imitate myself, you know. And that's not too far away, folks, I want you to know. When that happens, I would like to be part of a radio station somewhere, you know, and tell them what to do.
What little Jonathan Winters there.
Yeah.
What about this production company that you were talking about?
Well, that's another thing.
I.e. Stan Freberg type operation.
I think Willard and I both have tremendous amount of respect for Stan Freberg. The guy is a real genius. And we have done a few commercials over the years that have been run in this market and other places. We did some Federal Housing Administration things that we did comedy routines, but got the message across. And this is another thing we would very much like to do.
Want to get in a plug here, and this is an obvious direct appeal to credit where credit is due here. This station, of all the stations in Washington, D.C., and perhaps of all the stations in the United States of America, I don't know them all, so I can't speak, Mr. Goodfellow and Mr. Smith before him, the general manager, managers of these stations, they are the most fantastic people about allowing their local people to do outside
right.
work.
That's
they
right.
pay us a salary, even when we're not working, they pay us a salary.
Is it
terribly
all
terribly tolerant. Yes, isn't that terrible?
Oh,
isn't
my.
So
okay,
we have to have you back again.
I want to thank them very much for allowing Jim Simpson, who is a recent example of someone that went out and covered the Tokyo Olympics. They let him do anything that, within reason. And don't forget our television show Friday.
Oh, yes. That's right.
Oh, yes. Tell us the time. I'll just say goodbye now.
4:30.
Thank you so much.
Spook.
Spook
what is
Tactic.
It
called? Yeah. Okay, it's a cute show, and it won't offend anybody, but I don't want children, to, little babies.
Bye.
Ladies and gentlemen, the new president of the National Press Club is Bryson Rash, and while that may sound like the name of some minor disease afflicting teenage boys, it actually is a person. He is employed and paid by NBC News. He is the new president of the Press Club, and in our shop, this fact has brought both pleasure and consternation. Of course, we're glad one of our guys made it and all that, but we've been thinking about it a little bit, and we find that, well, Bryson is all right, but some of us were over here sitting around in the wasteland the other night, and we began to wonder if he really was the right man for this job. I mean, does he have the necessary qualities of mind and heart and character? Is he a suitable example for the youth of America? Well, some said they weren't really sure. So we began to investigate, and we found it wasn't easy because he has been at some pains to cover his tracks. But we nevertheless looked into it, trying to see something about his character, trying to see if he was sober and reliable or just reliable, trying to find out, in short, is Bryson Rash. He was born in Los Angeles in 1913. At a time when Americans generally were moving westward, the Rash family moved eastward, displaying the perversity that is still a part of his nature, as in the next year the Press Club may find out for itself. They moved eastward to Missouri, where Bryson was able to observe the Pendergast machine at work and to learn the techniques he was later to use at the Press Club and to seize power. He got his first job when he was 12.
I'm Buster Brown. I live in a shoe. That's my dog, Ty. He lives there, too.
Yes, that was Bryson, the original Buster Brown, in 1925, a fact he wishes we didn't know. And then, with fame and riches almost in his grasp at the age of 12, he blew it.
I'm Buster Brown. I live in a shoe.
I'm sorry, kid. That's it. Your voice has changed. You're through. You're fired.
But what about my dog, sir?
His voice has changed, too. You're both fired.
Then there was the high school romance, and he thought he might become a musician.
Betty, I've been working on something as sort of a surprise for you. I thought maybe I might be able to win your love this way. Listen. Well, what do you think, Betty?
Oh, I'm awfully sorry, Bryson, but I'm afraid there's someone else.
You mean...
Well, he lost the girl who, incidentally, and this is the truth, was Betty Grable, who married Harry James, a better trumpet player. And he also lost interest in music, or it lost interest in him, so he started college, got a part-time job as a piano salesman, and in this capacity called on Helen Traubel, then a voice teacher in St. Louis.
Gee, I sure hope Miss Traubel's home here. Knock on the door and see. Boy, this door-to-door piano salesman stuff is for the birds. Let me put this thing down. Miss Traubel, my name is Bryson Rash. I'm your friendly door-to-door piano salesman, and I'd like to show you the wonderful
and so,
virtues of this.
Poor Bryson tried to sell Helen Traubel her piano. Hard times had not left Bryson yet. For, as Bryson was demonstrating the piano, the lid fell down on his fingers, as you will observe here.
That was the end of his career as a piano salesman, and from then on until this day, it has been steadily downhill. He couldn't play the trumpet, he couldn't sell pianos, so he became a radio announcer. One of those who begins a commercial by saying, "Friends, do you have nagging backache, restless, sleepless nights?" Well, he said that line so badly, they moved him over into special events, where he opened each broadcast with the line, "We are speaking to you from the grand ballroom of the Chase Hotel." The trouble was, he could never think of anything to say after that, so he moved on to Cincinnati, to WLW, and then he came to Washington with the preposterous idea that CBS might give him a job. Of course it wouldn't, so he went into the government writing scripts. Right here, we wanted to read one of them to you, but we find he has burned them. The government did pay him, and he spent some of the money at American University, where he got a law degree. We were curious about that, so we went over and asked some questions.
Rash. Gee, that's a funny name. Boy, it makes me want to scratch just thinking about it here. Let's see now, what year was that? Yes, I remember. Great class. Wonderful class. Yes, six men are now judges, four in Congress. More than 20 are corporate lawyers. Rash. Oh, yes. He was the fellow with the silky voice who always wore those funny little bow ties. Wonder what ever happened to him.
While he was still studying law, NBC in Washington had a job open, and he made a name for himself, some sort of name, on one of his first assignments when he reported President Roosevelt's arrival at the Naval Gun Factory.
Guns will march past. Slow time. By the left.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. This is Bryson Rash speaking to you from the Naval Gun Factory in Washington, D.C. Momentarily, the president will arrive. It's a beautiful day here in Washington, and when the president makes his appearance, you will hear a 21 sun galoot. Oh.
He married Julie Jenkins, a bright, good-looking girl, then working at NBC, and so far as we know, that is what saved his job. So they sent him to the political conventions in 1940, and to everyone since, to the White House, the presidential trips, to San Francisco for the founding of the United Nations, to Wake Island for the meeting with General MacArthur, and along about here, he moved over to ABC. We cannot find out why, because both networks keep their personnel files under lock and key. But anyway, he moved, covered the Army-McCarthy hearings, and he was television pool reporter at the bomb test on Eniwetok.
This is ABC Radio, New York, calling Bryson Rash, Eniwetok.
And Rash, Eniwetok. Hello, ABC New York, can you hear me?
Coming in loud and clear, Bryson. Tell us about the big blast. How's it going?
As a matter of fact, the big blast is still going on here. We're having a wonderful time. I didn't know you knew about it there. We've got a few girls doing a hula and a nice Hawaiian band here and a little juice and a few hors d'oeuvres. It's a lot of laughs, New York. Really having a great time.
Bryson, apparently you misunderstood about the bomb. The bomb, Bryson.
Bomb? We're all bombed here. I am, Bob McCormick, Bob Considine. The whole blinking news staff is bombed here. Happy New Year, New York.
Along about here, for reasons also obscure, NBC took him back. One condition of his re-employment was that a program he had developed at ABC stay at ABC. It was one of the early television epics called the Tailwaggers Club. It was a sort of low-budget program that didn't have the money to hire any people, so Bryson, displaying cunning and guile, used animals. And during one of these productions, here's how it was in the control room.
Okay, gang, stand by. We're in the control room. Bryson's all set. Fix Bryson's tie. We have 10 seconds before we go on the air.
Bryson, let me fix your tie.
Put a little pat on the top of his head, too, will you?
Yeah, it's shining.
All right, stand by the music. Cue the music.
Cue the music.
Okay,
roll.
And then nice dolly shot. Okay,
dolly shot.
Cue the jackass.
Cue the jackass.
Not Bryson.
Oh.
Mule the jackass.
That one.
Do me a favor. Move that basket with the cobra in it back from Bryson a little bit, will you?
Is it safe?
Yeah, move it outside. Get out of the way.
All right,
stand by now. All right. Get a shot of the dog over there.
Shot close up. Yeah,
not that woman, the guest. The dog, the St. Bernard dog.
She's a real dog, isn't she?
Will you please do me a favor?
What?
Get that basket with the cobra. Move it away from Bryson.
All right. Come here.
Hey, wait a minute. Why did you kick the dog?
Well, he had his leg up in the air. He was going to kick me.
Will you get the basket with the cobra? Come it's too late. Anybody got a knife or something?
Yeah, why?
Go ahead and cut, make the X on Bryson's arm.
All right, get the blood and...
Get the cobra.
Call a doctor, will you? Somebody call first
Somebody
aid,
slap Bryson. Tell him we got 10
Bryson,
seconds.
Bryson, you're on
get
the
pad film
seconds.
Ready. What are you, Bryson's
Bryson,
on?
Will you get up?
Well, when he came back to NBC and we took his dogs away from him, we left him very little to do, so he threw himself into good works, civic and community activities and all that, leaving very little time for home life with his wife and daughters.
Julianne, darling, would you get the phone for Mother, please?
Okay, Mommy. Hello? Oh, hi, Daddy.
Who is it, darling?
It's Daddy, Mom.
Where is he?
He's down at the press club. He said he won't be home for dinner.
Oh, for heaven's sakes. I didn't mind the Rotary Club. I didn't mind the Cherry Blossom Festival. I didn't mind the March of Dimes, the Heart Fund, the Civic Association here in Wesley Heights, the Anteaters Club, and the Friends of the Zoo, but not coming. What's he doing down at that press club anyway?
I think he's building something, Mommy.
What do you mean?
Well, I just heard him ask the man for a screwdriver.
By now, Bryson was on the ladder and a fixture at the press club bar. Those are some of the things that happened to Bryson on his way to the bottom. But to get some additional information, the kind that reveals the real heart and soul of a man, NBC sent reporters out to ask around. Well, most of them didn't want to go, feeling they already knew more about Bryson than anybody needed to know, but one who did go was Richard Harkness.
This is Richard Harkness, apathetically participating in the saga of Bryson Rash. My unhappy assignment was tracking down distaff members of the Washington News Corps whose bark is worse than their bite. My trail led to the Senate Press Gallery. There, in a corner, I came upon Sarah McClendon. She was taking inventory.
El Paso Times, Sherman Democrat, San Antonio Light, Austin American, Waco News Tribune, Austin Statesman, Port Arthur News, Union Leader, Vermont, let's see now, St. Albans.
21, 22, 23. Pardon me, Sarah. As one of the News Corps' automatic reactors, I'd like your views on Bryson Rash's becoming president of the National Press Club.
His year may be marked by an historic development, for there is the report that Bobby Kennedy will now turn to integrating both the women's and the men's national press clubs. So I have an offer. I want to be the first to sponsor Bryson for membership in the Women's Press Club. Then, hand in hand, we can join in a campaign against sex segregation of the Cosmos Club, the Army and Navy Club, the Metropolitan Club, and others.
A fetching picture, that. Next, my object was the inscrutable May Craig. My journalistic instinct led me unerringly to the hat department of a downtown department store. There she was. I said, May, come out from under that hat. I know you. Now, May, about Bryson Rash becoming president of the...
I would like to know, do you think women are people, and if so, why?
But, May, I'd like to
now,
ask you...
Now, you know, the other night, Senator Ted Kennedy spoke to the Women's National Press Club, and he opened up by saying, now that we are all here, meaning Jack, Bobby, and Teddy, now I want to ask you, Mr.
May,
President,
a question,
do
if you
please. Think they are all here, or will they just keep coming?
But, May...
There. Now, you see, after Jack and Bobby and Teddy have all been president, there'd still be two terms before Caroline would be old enough. Do you think they might get the Constitution changed so that Caroline could be the first woman president? And what are we going to do with all the seven Bobby children? Will they have terms, too?
May, I
want to... Aside from politics, I want to ask you about this new style of empire high-waisted dresses for women. Now, you approve of wandering waistlines, or do you like them so you know where you can find them? You remember in the sack dresses, there just weren't any, and you never exactly did know.
Well, I tried, but you know May. Well, next, who else but NBC's own Patty Kavin? I found Patty warming up for her daily broadcast. Patty, take a breath.
Has been known to advocate, don't go
Patty,
to college.
Patty, as president of the Women's Press Club, you must have encountered Bryson.
You know, Richard, Bryson Rash is one of my favorite men, which may strike terror into the hearts of you hairy-chested press club types, some of whom still refuse to face the fact that women are here to stay. Now, Bryson is different. He's charming, he's debonair, and sometimes he's dangerous. I trust you all have considered that B plus rash spells brash, which could be indicative of the upcoming National Press Club administration. When a man can concentrate on red china and still keep the price of Press Club pickles in mind, you guys have picked yourselves a winner. This is Patty Kavin, president of the Women's National Press Club.
And this is Richard Harkness, hurrying to the still, thank heaven, sex-segregated National Press Club bar.
Around the office here, Bryson used to tell us how many presidents he knew. He was never quite clear about whether they knew him, so Robert McCormick went out and asked some of them.
The grand old man of Missouri, for example, what did Mr. Truman think of the performance of our own personal president as a figure in the public eye?
People like to see what's going on, and you can't tell. At least I can't. I guess I'm dumb. I can't tell on television or these darn things either whether the fellow is actually believing what he says or not.
Well, how then do you account for the massive popularity that has survived continuous exposure to the public since the days of Horace Greeley?
People in this great country are emotional and sentimental. They like a hero and often fall for all sorts of soap and toothpaste advertising about him.
You have no doubt heard the charges that Mr. Rash contemplates an even sterner dictatorship than we have been forced to drink under in past administrations.
If we are in the shape that we ought to be, and we're slowly and gradually becoming in that shape, we won't have any trouble with those birds.
You once enjoyed, if that's the word, a reputation as an expert on political machines. If we need your help to free ourselves from the shackles of electronic arrogance and tyranny, what can we do?
If mistakes are big enough and go on long enough, I can find out about them out in Missouri, even from reading the Kansas City Star.
Well, this penetrating analysis of what the future holds prompted us to turn toward Gettysburg. The first question was blunt and direct, as was the answer. As a man with presidential experience on the grand scale, what did he think about the election of Mr. Rash?
It was a rather sad day for the United States.
Does Mr. President Sr. agree with charges that Mr. President Jr. intends to destroy what little freedom club members have left?
I have said, and it has been, I think, stated by one or two of my associates, we are going to make it a little bit less free. This isn't a turnaround and reversal of walking going in another direction.
Have you heard anything, Mr. President, about proposals that efforts be made to get reporters into the press club, return the press club to the press, so to speak?
Nothing recently. It's one of those matters that is kept always on the agenda, and you make inquiry whenever you can, but we've heard nothing.
How would you feel if the Rash administration turned out to be liberal?
If the time ever comes when I feel that my duty compels me to say a word of any kind, I'll say it, and you don't have to look, you won't have to worry about what it'll be stated positively and definitely.
Well, now we get into what might be called contemporary politics. We sought out a typical progressive view of what has been happening. So what, Mr. President, do you think of Mr. Rash as our leader?
I would not have supported him for the presidency if I had not believed that he would be an effective and responsible president.
You are not worried about bumbling administration or pompous despotism?
I think that some of the fears have been exaggerated. In any case, we've done it.
How effective do you consider the basic issue in this last campaign of free pickles with each pousse-café?
No, I don't think that any comment that I might make would necessarily be accurate, because there's a variety of opinions in regard to the matters which may be in dispute. And in addition, I think that it's a matter which we should study. There's no assurances that it means it's helpful to us or harmful as yet.
In your opinion, the new administration won't do any permanent damage?
I do think it would be well for the us all to recognize that in the first place, these men are not going to be kept in longer than a year. There has never been such a proposal that I've ever heard of. Newspaper reports to the contrary, notwithstanding, this has never been suggested. Secondly, it is our hope to get these men out before their 12-month period.
On a more personal basis, how do you regard Mr. Rash's professional work as a radio and television commentator?
Rash talk is cheap.
What is your opinion of his ostensible friendliness when he was campaigning?
I repeat the conclusion that rash talk is cheap.
He has told some of us that he will reduce prices and improve the service, the food, and the booze.
I repeat the conclusion that rash talk is cheap.
In summary, can you give us a capsule assessment of Mr. Rash?
Rash talk is cheap.
Well, that's it. The truth about Bryson Rash. And I guess it's about all anyone needs to know, because if we told you the rest of it, it would only send you away depressed. Anyway, he is president. The election is over, even though there have been some charges of fast counting among club members from Chicago. And we are convinced that the real basic trouble in this case, as in so many others, is public apathy. Good night, Bryson.
I have listened with anguish and with a heavy heart the scandalous attack bordering on treason by my colleagues at NBC and others. As for NBC, that's nothing but canards. I am deeply wounded as I look back over the years that I bought these men drinks, even a hamburger now and then, with free press club pickles. I was running for office then and needed the votes. Who needs them now? Brinkley, a refugee from that bird sanctuary of Wilmington, North Carolina. Harkness, the prototype of a minister's son who went wrong. The Joy Boys, that's what killed radio. McCormick, a star of Muzak and closed-circuit television. This attack on my administration is the classic example in ever-living color of the adage that a prophet is without honor. Thank heavens this is a non-profit organization. This house, the National Press Club, has many bars, I mean rooms. To them, I went seeking friends and loyal supporters who have stood beside me in the past and will in the future at the many bars, I mean rooms. I called upon them, the leading members and voters of this club, to bear witness to the superb men of high principle who will make up the Rash administration, perhaps the last frontier of the press club. Of the distinguished vice president, the chairman of the General Advisory Committee, George Cullen, had this to say.
Your new vice president, Joe Deere, is eminently qualified for his office. As an old-time Jersey City politician and businessman, he knows how to meet a payroll and let somebody else worry about balancing the budget. Mr. President, I suggest that you keep your eye on this man. He is the strong, silent type who wields great influence in the press club inner circle. As a graduate of the Mayor Haig School of Politics, he knows how to get things done, even if you don't want them done. Joe will be your liaison man on the House Committee, which controls the spending for improvements around this club. Be on your guard, Mr. President, or he may decide to take over the main lounge for the card room. As vice president, Joe Deere will be an excellent asset to your administration. You can count on him to make sure that you are a one-term president, just as you made sure I was.
George, if you had really wanted to run again, I would have been happy to stand aside for you. Of the secretary of the club, former president Lou Warren has this accolade.
You will have to forgive my harshness. I was trying to be the poor man's Bill Blair and tried a Turkish bath, but only got laryngitis. I don't believe that any in his vast audience in the New York Times is aware of Bill's health club fanaticism. And come to think of it, what vast audience? Well, anyway, there are some who do know the rubdown on Bill. The boys on the New York Times know that when a hot agriculture story breaks around noon, they can't count on Bill Blair. Bill is on a local steam table, and not even Scotty Reston can see him. Well, I guess this routine never would have been broken up if May Smith hadn't needed some press club letters signed and barged right into the YMCA's inner sanctum. And that's the reason, children, for the new watermark in the press club stationery, to say nothing of the new gleam in May Smith's eyes.
A noble accomplishment, noble. The treasurer of the new administration is a man of purpose and drive and integrity. or he'd better be. Who knows him better than one of his colleagues, Ben Grant?
L. David Leroy is your new treasurer. He didn't especially want to be treasurer. He just wanted to get elected to something, and he ran for a job that nobody else was running for. He'll do well as treasurer. The treasurer just does what May Smith tells him to do. I asked him about his fiscal policy, and he said, well, yes, he was for it. He's under some pressure to cut dues. There's a theory on the new frontier that if you cut dues, you get more revenue. This confuses L. David, but he says he'll look into it and make a judgment. He works for U.S. News and World Report. He's a desk man there. And he's a nice guy. I know what you're thinking, but there are desk men who are nice guys, and L. David is one of them.
Then there is the financial secretary. I know he has the courage which marked my tenure in that office. I sent myself a dunning letter for an unpaid food check. An elder statesman of the press club, Charlie Gridley, extols the virtues of this newest member of the slate of officers.
Vernon Louvier says that most of his press club reputation rests on the happiness of little girls. He has run the father and daughter night party for little darlings under 12. So he and another outstanding Frenchman, Maurice Chevalier, have the same theme song, Thanks for Little Girls. Vernon is a native of Romeville, Louisiana, along the river road between New Orleans and Baton Rouge. It was natural that he should attend Louisiana State University, working his way through on the Baton Rouge Advocate. That paper still thrives, but otherwise, he says in his, that he has been a harbinger of ill luck. Four papers on which he worked have either merged or folded, the last being the lamented Washington Times Herald. He starts on the press club ladder, the bottom rung, under favoring auspices. The Bascom N. Timmons News Bureau, where he labors, once had three past presidents of the press club on its staff, but a fourth is a warning, but it will take more than the usual time.
The pivotal job in the Rash administration, as it has been in those which have passed, is that of the chairman of the Board of Governors. Here we have a rock of a man whose pebble-like qualities are placed in proper perspective by former President Jack Horner.
Our board chairman is a gavel-pounding, cigar-chomping, evil old Scotsman named Kermit MacFarland. He was born in the territory of Iowa about a century ago, but left as soon as Pennsylvania politics became corrupt enough to accommodate him as a statehouse reporter. A paper called the Harrisburg Patriot, living up to its name, unloaded him on the Pittsburgh Press, which in turn farmed him out to the Scripps Howard editorial board in Washington. Editor-in-chief Walker Stone, an old Indian giver, palmed him off on Press Club. McFarland has now set up light housekeeping here. He wears an apron in the kitchen and dusts off the board chairmanship every time a vote comes up. He's never been known to be early for anything, never known to be late, never known to run for president, and never known to forget you when you get sick or have a birthday or celebrate your golden wedding. The big trouble with the man is that if you gave him 500 pounds of steel wool, he would knit you an iron stove.
A man of steel. The vice chairman of the board watches over with a beady eye the virtues of those who apply for membership in this august club. This man must be one of strength and decision. Ted Koop knows about that.
The trouble with Lou Schollenberger is that when he says he will do something, he goes ahead and does it. Nothing stops him. This indelicate sense of responsibility can be of serious import for the Rash administration. And for the record, let me note here that the word Rash is capitalized. It is traditional that the president of the club is the only actor, or rather, man of action. Board members can be seen and heard, frequently at considerable length, but they should never do anything. True, Board Chairman Kermit MacFarland has violated this principle on occasion, but it is to be expected that President Rash will restore him to innocuous desuetude, to quote Teddy Roosevelt. Schollenberger will be much more difficult to hold in check. Over the years, he has served as chairman of every major committee of the club, and that experience has given him ideas, always a dangerous sign. Consequently, Mr. President, I should warn you, Schollenberger knows where the bodies are buried, and he's likely to dig them up. Treat him cautiously.
The untitled, as yet, members of the Board of Governors are the swing influence in any administration. I can count on the fingers of one hand those who will support me completely. There are five of them. The sometime poet laureate of the members' bar, Fletcher Knievel, tells of the first of these.
Now we come to a fellow named Clark, a Mollenhof big as a park. Ancestry ain't Russian, it's really more Prussian, with some of the genes of the shark. His hobby is news of the sinner, the pro, and not the beginner. He'd love to indict the left and the right and consume Mr. Hoffa for dinner. Now the shark lurks near to the shoals, where he preys on a Bundy or Bowles. But this you remember, he'll never dismember an in-law or brother named Coles.
I am content with that shark on my side. Who would know better the qualities of a New York Times man than one who works for the Daily News? The latter is Frank Holman.
The Virginia gentleman on the Board of Governors in the Rash administration is Cabell Phillips of the New York Times. He's smooth and mellow with just the right amount of kick. Cab was born and raised in Williamsburg. The Rockefellers later spent millions of dollars restoring the town to its original condition. He graduated from Richmond College and got his first newspaper job on the Richmond Times-Dispatch. Then he went on to greater things. He came to Washington to work for the WPA as a public relations man for the Leaf Rakers. This prepared him for important jobs with the Time Magazine, the Department of Justice, the Chicago Herald American, and finally the New York Times and the National Press Club. President Rash will get plenty of help from Governor Phillips, whether he wants it or not.
There are others who will bring honor and action to the Rash administration. Another distinguished former president of the press club, John Cosgrove, tells of one of them.
Among the more interesting press club characters on the board, Win Booth ranks high. This Rolling Stone from Little Rock has been a genuine Arkansas traveler since he graduated from the Missouri School of Journalism in 1933. Not a gambling man, Win has made a success of sure bets. During the Truman Dewey campaign, as White House correspondent for Time, he cleaned up, betting to the hilt on Harry Truman, taking all the 10-to-1 money available. Like Truman, Booth believes in the two-party system, so long as the Democrats win. When the red-headed dynamo pauses from his press club activities, he runs the National Geographic Society's news service and makes worldwide trips that would be the envy of any junketing congressman. May Smith will never really understand how Booth kept track of the club's money as treasurer last year, but after a careful audit of the books, not one cent was left unaccounted for nor unspent. I give you a man on the move, a man to watch, Governor Win Booth.
I'll watch him. Believe me, I'll watch him. There is a quiet one among us who is restful and soothing in the midst of strife and turmoil. A magazine writer of renown, Fred Blumenthal, knows him well.
Mike Hutterbach is very mysterious. For example, he's discovered a secret formula that allows him to write 1,000 words a month. Get that, 1,000 words a month for Sports Afield. Most of us write that many commas in one day. And Mike lives in luxury, 49 miles from Washington. He drives to work every day. I figure he drives 3 miles for each word he writes. That's my boy. He's got a world's record in there someplace. And while Mysterious Mike produces one word a month for every 3 miles he travels, Abe Lincoln had to produce a word for every half mile on his way to Gettysburg. The conclusion is obvious. Mike Hutterbach's prose is just 6 times as good as Lincoln's. Unfortunately, we can't have old honest Abe on the Board of Governors. But does it really matter? We've got Mysterious Mike. Exactly how Mike Hutterbach turned 1,000 words a month into a $1 million Virginia estate is his secret. But whatever it is, Hutterbach's the kind of guy I want on my side. Maybe some of his secrets will rub off on all of us.
Then there is the bachelor member of the Board of Governors, who thus can be called upon to do yeoman work for the Rash administration. He has no commitments save to his president. And if you want to know about the UPI, ask an AP man. That's the case here, a distinguished former president of this club, Tony Vaccaro.
Warren Duffy brings a lot to his new term on the Board of Governors. That lot includes a passion for holding office. Tell him of a vacancy and he's a candidate. You can give him the details later. Duffy not only runs at the press club, he's now on the standing committee of correspondents on Capitol Hill. He's not a member of the Women's National Press Club for obvious reasons. That being so, he's not running after anything there except the women members. He's southern-born and southern-bred. He may add corn pone, catfish, and whippoorwill peas to the press club menu. Duffy only turns Yankee at the bar. There he orders scotch. And he's worn shoes so long he hardly notices having them on. Duffy's also a great athlete, especially indoors and in warm weather. He can carry two pencils and a notepad without help and without breathing heavily at all. It happens that he's with the UPI, and Duffy's got great courage there. He's an outspoken admirer of Lyle Wilson.
Well, there it is. Sort of a Dorian Gray picture, isn't it? But what have I got to lose? Come to think of it, what have you got to lose? I'm going to stand on this record. Hey, Madigan, make it a double bourbon.